Hey y'all, happy Pride Month. Since I started this channel like 3-ish years ago, I've done a Pride Month episode every year. The first year I did my top 5 LGBT games, and last year I covered 25 LGBT games for you to play. I was thinking about what else to do this year, because I play so many queer games on this channel, it doesn't make sense for me to make another video about LGBT games because I don't know what I could teach y'all or talk about that I don't already do on a regular basis, if that makes sense. So I decided that I'd rather just talk about my top 5 favorite pieces of LGBT media, books, films, TV shows, comics, games, whatever. Like my previous videos, these aren't going to be ranked in any particular order. I'm just going to talk about what they are and why I like them. So without further ado, let's get started. Number 1, Strangers in Paradise, a comic series. Strangers in Paradise is a comic written by legendary Eisner Award-winning artist Terry Moore. It centers on the drama and relationships surrounding three friends, Francine, Kachu, and David. Francine struggles with eating disorders, bad relationships with men, and coming to terms with her sexuality. Kachu is a former sex worker who has struggled with alcohol addiction, rage issues, and abusive relationships. David was abused by his older sister as a child, has done some really awful things, and relies on his faith to try to navigate how to be a better person, but sometimes does this at the risk of pissing off others in the friend group because of his holier-than-thou attitude. SIP is about a lot of things, but ultimately, I'd argue that it's about the long, long road to recovery from trauma. The series stretches out over the course of several years. Sometimes the characters make the same mistakes over and over again. Sometimes the characters are egregiously awful to each other, and it takes a long time for them to make up for it. And some of the characters find that there are things in this life that you never truly learn to let go of, but you have to learn to live with them. I'm not kidding when I say that this series literally saved my life as a kid. There was a period of time when young adult fiction was horrible. Y'all have to keep in mind that I grew up during the era where Twilight and Hunger Games were at their peak. So at that time, the market for kids' fiction was oversaturated with vampire stories and half-baked dystopian literature. Not only that, but honestly, the heroines of YA fiction were depicted strangely. Their lives almost always revolved around men. They had little to no motivation for what they wanted to do aside from like get married and fall in love and settle down with these guys. But they were also depicted as having little to no emotion. They don't cry, they don't get angry. They were beautiful, but not in an overt, embracing it kind of way, but rather an I'm so beautiful and I don't know it, teehee, kind of way. Now, here's me, little queer kid that could care less about love triangles and resents the way that women are presented as masculine and unfeeling in literature, which seems a little misogynistic, but like that's a story for another time. So I was looking at these stories and I'm like, wow, no one here looks like me, acts like me, thinks like me. Where do I fit in? And I just so happen to stumble across these comic books in the YA section of the library. I pick up the first pocketbook and I devour it in less than a day. Now look, I started reading Strangers in Paradise probably at an age when I was too young for it, but regardless, it's had a major impact on my life, and a positive one at that. Here was the first time in my whole life that I felt represented in fiction. There were queer women, there were plus-size women, there were women who were smart but also gorgeous, and women who were more masculine presenting and super ripped. There were just a lot of really cool women in the series, and I felt more represented, seen, and understood by this series than, honestly, than anything that other female authors were writing back then. Except for maybe like Tamora Pierce, her stuff was always cool, but that's a side thought. Nowadays, SIP is watered down by critics and treated like a soap opera, and while it certainly has its unrealistic or melodramatic moments, I really appreciate the series for how it tries to depict queer women in multidimensional ways. Side note, if you're interested in checking out this series, you should probably also check out Love and Rockets. Number 2, Aristotle and Dante Discover the Secrets of the Universe. This is a book which focuses on Ari, a Mexican-American teenager growing up in the Southwest, and his relationship and budding romance with his best friend Dante. It takes place in the 1980s and follows them as they're growing up. Now here's the thing, this isn't exclusively a coming out story. Yes, Ari is struggling with his sexuality and feelings for Dante throughout the entire book, but there are way more things happening underneath the surface. Ari struggles to connect with his father, a Vietnam War vet. He's also deeply missing his brother who went to prison a long time ago and whose family never talks about anymore. Ari is also developing anger issues which are threatening to consume them. And also, there's a lot of conversations surrounding identity, what it means to be a Mexican-American, what it means to be Latinx in this world, what it means to be queer in Latinx. It's a really fascinating and multidimensional look at identity. And the author, Benjamin Aliere Sáenz, addresses all of these things with a poeticism and fluidity that is like, I mean, my god, is this book his magnum opus. If you haven't read it, pick it up. 3, Girlfriends. This series by Milk Morinaga has pretty much become a staple of the Yuri genre in manga. Prior to coming across the series, I mean, I hated a lot of Yuri fiction. Frequently, the genre included a lot of sister-sister pairings, gross, or were obviously made for the male gaze. It didn't seem like a genre that was really geared towards women, which is funny because it's literally all about women. And I've read staples like Aoihana, which avoided the bad cliches of the genre, but I hated it, and for reasons that I'm not really going to explain right now. Girlfriends was the first Yuri manga which mirrored my own experiences when it came to falling in love with girls and coming to terms with my sexuality. It follows a very wholesome friendship of two girls, Marie and Akko, which later blossoms into a romance. They also have a group of friends that they hang out with, and they have their own mini adventures throughout the course of the series. One thing that I appreciate about this series is that a lot of their conflicts don't revolve around competing against each other. Like, these girls all love and support one another and recognize each other's strengths. The conflicts largely arise from Marie's self-esteem issues or her inability to suppress her desires for Akko. Later, it also focuses on how they plan to keep the relationship going after high school, even as they consider pursuing different paths. Highly recommend giving this a read if you haven't already. Number 4, Steven Universe. Yes, y'all, I know that Steven Universe has its share of problems, particularly in the sequel series and the ending of the show, but I'm not going to get into that right now. Steven Universe was important to me as a teenager because it was the first instance of queer characters really being at the forefront of their own stories. This was the first major show I saw where queer people weren't just side characters that revolved around some straight girl's life. Also, it was the first show on Cartoon Network to be created by a non-binary woman, so like, that was pretty awesome and inspiring for me. SU was great in how it depicted healthy queer relationships and explored issues regarding consent, parental relationships, mental health, and recovering from grief. Number 5, Fake. This, like Strangers in Paradise, also made a significant impact on me as a kid. I'm planning on making a video that goes further into depth about Fake and why I think it's so amazing, but I just wanted to briefly touch base on it here. So if you're familiar with yaoi and boys love genres, you'll know that a lot of them involve sexual assault or rape scenes. Fake was one of the few mangas that I read where the relationship between the characters was not only consensual, but unfolded over the course of several books in a really beautiful way. Fake centers on two NYPD detectives, Dee and Ryo, and the nefarious crimes that they work to solve. It also, to a lesser extent, focuses on Ryo's misadventures in parenting his adopted son, Bicky, the smart but mischievous kid. He's really used for comedy relief, but God, I do love this child. I particularly love this series for the same reasons that I love Strangers in Paradise. It's about two characters, each with their own traumatic pasts, looking to work through their grief, unlearn bad behaviors, and accept the love that they've been craving their whole lives. It's not just a love story, it's a story about found family. Side note, this is also the first BL story where the female characters aren't just there to be homophobic or steal someone's man. FBI agent Diana certainly has moments where she flirts with the men, but she's ultimately just this badass take-charge woman who comes to their rescue, like, a lot of times. Carol, Bicky's best friend and love interest, also has her own detailed story arcs, not just in the side stories at the end of the books, but in the main storyline as well. I do have a few honorable mentions on this list, which I really won't go into, but I think they're still awesome and I want to give them a shout-out, so here they are. Adventure Time. Not really queer media, but I love how Marcy and Bubblegum's relationship was explored over the years and how it kind of naturally unfolded. Number 2, She-Ra. Love the effortless inclusivity of all different kinds of queer characters. Number 3, Lumberjanes. I didn't really read this until I was an adult, but gosh, do I love these kids and their wacky adventures. Number 4, Yuri on Ice. The romance isn't the focus of the show, it's just really a side plot, and I love how fluidly it's incorporated into the narrative. Number 5, But I'm a Cheerleader, groundbreaking for a lot of reasons. Number 6, Moonlight, another groundbreaking narrative that puts black queer men at the center of their own stories and just kind of focuses on romance. I mean, really, it is a really good story. I love it. Number 7, The Half of It. This is, again, is another amazing story kind of that I really related to because it's about growing up in a small, really Christian town. It's a love story, but it's a love story for like reasons that you wouldn't expect. So definitely check that on Netflix if you haven't already. So that brings this video to a close. As a reminder, and as I've mentioned in previous Pride Month episodes, we can keep the spirit for the LGBT community going year-round. I'm going to leave some links to some charities in a pinned comment for this video. Feel free to throw a couple bucks their way if you can. Thanks for watching this video. If you liked it, please leave a like. It really does help the channel out. Also, consider subscribing to the channel for playthroughs on queer indie games and more ramblings about queer media. Thanks again, everyone. Bye! Special shout out to Patreons AceWolf741, Deep Dive Dylan, Brian White, Caleb Putnam, and Robin Harper.